Ladies and gentlemen, it's about time to start our final session, a session that will end our conference with a musical note and una gita to Roma, a trip to Rome, and the production of exotic books. And with this weather, what do you want more? I'll introduce first Laurent Guillo. He obtained his PhD at the École pratique des hautes études and spent time in the library business afterwards. He studies manuscript sources of music in the 16th and 17th centuries, music collections, bibliographies, and material context of music up to the 18th century. His book historical research includes technical, intellectual, and trade aspects of publishing. And currently, he's a member of the IReMus Institute in Paris. And that has four legs, that institute. It's almost a human being, or an animal, at least. CNRS, BNF, BNF, well-known, Ministère de la Culture and the Sorbonne. Well, it's just too good not to mention, you know. So the floor is yours, Laurent.
I keep it for future use.
Yeah.
Thank you. During the last years, I have been working on the Ballard workshop in Paris, the most important music printer in France during nearly two centuries. I could gather and find new documents related to the music book trade, mostly catalogues, inventories, and contracts, a few invoices too. My purpose was to analyze these documents and try to share the main results with you. First of all, I must underline that the music book trade is rather specific. It makes from 3 to 5% of the total book trade, depending on what you include in music books, with or without liturgies, with or without psalm books, and so on. In many countries, there has been one music printer in prominent position, the Ballard family in Paris, Estienne Roger in Amsterdam, John Walsh in London, because the music book trade is a niche with very few printers in it. Sometimes they went into rough competition on an international scale. From about 1670 on, two technical processes are competing, the original process of typography and the emerging process of music engraving. In France, these two processes were driven by completely different administrative rules. Typography was ruled by privileges, masters, and the printers' guild, but engraving was always a free trade. I can briefly illustrate this competition between music typography and music engraving with a score of the opera Roland by Jean-Baptiste Lully. You see here left a 1685 edition in typography and right a 1716 edition in music engraving, on engraved plates. My paper will try to answer a few questions. In Paris and Amsterdam, in the 1660 to 1725 period, what makes the cost and the price of music books? Why and when do these prices vary? I will study these points using three kinds of sources: the contracts between composers and printers, the price lists published by booksellers, Ballard in Paris, Roger, he was French actually, Roger and Mortier in Amsterdam, the sale catalogues on second-hand music books. A last word before I begin. In France, the main currency at that time was the livre tournois. I will call it a pound to make it simpler. A pound makes 20 sols and one sol makes 12 deniers. In Paris, I have found only 10 contracts signed by a printer and a composer between 1659 and 1712, all in notarial archives except one in a private correspondence. That's not much compared to hundreds and hundreds of music prints published at the time. This means that most of the contracts were just private contracts and were not notarized. These contracts are also important because the archives of the Ballard workshop have burned in 1750. There are two kinds of contracts. First, the printing contract. The printer works for the composer. The paper is browsed by the composer. The printer sends the stock to the composer. The composer sells his stock. He can also leave a part of the stock at the printer's bookshop. The printer is paid for the technical costs, but the commercial risk is assumed by the composer. So the printer is paid for a printing service, and that's all. And then the publishing contract. Here the printer buys the privilege to the composer and then assumes all the technical tasks and costs and sells the book for his own profit. The printer assumes the commercial risk. These two kinds of contracts are fundamentally different because the commercial risk is not on the same side. And you find about half and half. In the six printing contracts, we find two different sets of parameters. Either the print run in yellow on the lines above, in yellow, either the print run and the cost price per printed sheet per print run, not including paper, or the print run and the total sum paid to the printer, not including paper. For each of these contracts, the cost of paper remains unknown because paper was brought by the composer and it was a way for the composer to be sure that the printer will not over-invoice the paper to him. It was estimated at £5 per ream, this value coming from another contract. I have calculated the cost price of one copy. Then it was divided by the number of sheets to give the cost price per printed sheet, which is rather consistent. It goes from 0.021 to 0.034 pounds per sheet. I used decimal pounds, not sous denier. This cost price includes paper, typesetting, correcting, press work, and amortization costs of the presses and so on. We also have four publishing contracts signed between 1659 and 1712. Here again, the contract gave us either the print run and the cost price per printed sheet per print run, without paper, or the print run and the total sum paid to the printer, not including paper. Here the cost price per printed sheet goes from 0.022 to 0.049 pounds per printed sheet. So, despite the two different kinds of contracts and the different sets of parameters they mention, we can find a cost price per printed sheet which is rather stable in a proportion of from 1 to 2.2. I did not make the comparison with non-musical books yet in equivalence format, in folio or in quarto, but I will. I will. I must add a point. When I calculate the cost price in a publishing contract, the second kind of contract, I have to take the cost of the privilege transfer into account, of course. We have some figures here and there. We find £1,050 paid by the master singer Bertrand Bassilly to Michel Lambert for 30 airs. £2,000 paid to by Christophe Ballard to the composer André Campras for the Ballet des Muses, and the same value for the subsequent examples. £2,000 is quite a bit of money at this time. This is only the transposition for music publishing of a practice which was already common in book publishing. For literature, these costs were going from a few hundreds to a few thousand pounds, depending on the work and the reputation of the author. For Molière, Racine, and Corneille, and all these writers, we have equivalent sums. In the second part, I'll use another kind of sources, the bookseller's catalogue. And there are many, thanks God. The Ballard workshop used to print a complete catalogue each year or so. The first we have is dated 1683, but shows no prices. We have 15 more from 1697 to 1742, all with prices. The last ones also include the production of their competitors, the Boivin and the Leclerc bookshops, specialized in engraved music. In Amsterdam, we also have many catalogues from the Estienne Roger bookshop, a Protestant of French origin, from 1696 to 1744. These ones are mostly printed at the end of books he published. Some questions arise. What is the relation between the thickness of the volume, that is the quantity of music printed, and its list price? What is the list price in Amsterdam of a book imported from Paris, and the opposite? What is the impact of the technical process, typography versus engraving? Why and when do these prices vary? I have made a short sample of prints taken from several genres, air, cantatas, motets, masses, spiritual music, and so on, which can be traced in several successive catalogues. Their list prices per printed sheet have been compared for unbound copies. This template shows the relation between the number of printed sheets in horizontal scale and the list price per printed sheet in vertical scale. We see that the smaller volumes, from 3 to 10 sheets, are the most expensive, and the price is rather erratic. For bigger volumes, more than 30 sheets, that's motets or operas mostly, the list price per sheet decreases and becomes stable, about £0.20 per sheet. Even less, at £0.10 per sheet for bigger volumes, about 125 sheets. That is big, big operas or motets for double chorus, so bigger scores. Now we can compare the cost price and the list price of a printed sheet. The cost price is multiplied by about 5 to make the list price. This is, of course, subject to variations to a print to another, but it's the average figure. So the benefit was 80% when it was sold. In France, the Ballard printers were champions of music typography. They tried to postpone the change to music engraving as late as possible, because it's difficult to go from a privileged situation to a free situation, of course. But from 1660, they had to print a few music books with engraving instead of typography, because of the limitation of typography for musical notation. These books were mostly organ or harpsichord music books. What was the influence of the technical process on the list price? I took another sample of music books, all engraved and coming from the Ballard bookshop. And when I calculate the list price per printed sheet, the result is quite different. Here again, the smaller the book is, the list price per printed sheet is high, and sometimes erratic again, as you can see on the left of the curve. When the book becomes thicker and thicker, the list price per printed sheet decreases to £0.3 per sheet, thrice as much expensive than for music typography, which was about 0.1. This is at least what occurs in the Ballard workshop, where both technical processes were used. The difference between prices in typography and engraving has also been studied by my colleague Rudolf Rasch in Utrecht University, using the catalogues of Estienne Roger. He finds similar results, although he uses different scales in his templates. For the quarto format, he compares the list price depending on the number of pages, for a specific format, of course. For a book of 100 pages, the list price goes from 2 guilders in typography to 4.5 guilders in engraving. It's more than doubled. For in-folio books, the price for 120 pages goes from 4.5 guilders in typography to 9 guilders if it is engraved. It's doubled. In both cases, this difference comes from the inherent cost of the press work, which is much longer for engraving than for typography, of course. In typography, printing one side of the sheet takes about 20 or 30 seconds if you get a heavy and muscular pressman. With engraved plates, you have first to ink the plates, then wipe them, then press them under a pressing roll, and this takes much more than 30 seconds. So if more time is needed, the daily run is smaller, and the part of the salary of the pressman in the cost price is, of course, higher, and the list price follows. So as I told you, in the ratio from 1 to 2, from 1 to 3, which is very significant in terms of list prices, of course. But if music engraving was that expensive, why did it win the competition against music typography? Was it a significant success for music publishing? Yes, but for other reasons. Because this trade was free, and any composer could get his music printed without praying Ballard to do so. Because there was no need of large print runs of several hundred copies. The average print run in the Ballard workshop is from 500 to 800 copies. You could just print what you needed first, say 50 copies, and keep a very small stock. The financial risk was rather low. And because it was always possible to make some corrections between the printing runs, and because you could keep the plates as a proof of your property on the music. For all these reasons, music engraving won the war against music typography. In the future, I'll try to calculate the same ratios in the production of Boivin and Leclerc workshops in Paris in the 1700 to 1750 period. The full collection of the Ballard catalogues also give the opportunity to show the increase of prices during about 50 years. With the first sample of books I already used before, I can put the list price on a template with time on horizontal scale and prices on the vertical scale. This sample is a bit short. I should strengthen it for publication later, I think. We see that there is a general increase in 1714 and 1715 of about 50%, which is a lot. In 1715, Christophe, the former director of the Ballard workshop, died, and the business went to his son, Jean-Baptiste Christophe. Obviously, he decided to increase all prices. I thought there was, but there is no direct link with the monetary inflation which occurred with the Lao financial crisis. This happened only about the 1720, and all these price increases were before. There is a pretty good stability of list prices after 1727. Two examples, the list price of the polyphonic masses are multiplied by 2.5 between 1704 and 1727. The masses are less and less published and become harder to find. And some books become rare and their prices take off. For instance, the score of the Triomphe de l'Amour by Lully goes from £13 to £32 before it becomes out of stock. It's the price which takes off just before the yellow bar. And it vanished from the catalogues after that. Now we can have a look at what happened between Paris and Amsterdam. At the very beginning of the 18th century, up to 1705, the Ballard and Roger firms exchanged some dozens of music books. They thought it was more clever to exchange their production instead of pirating themselves. The catalogues are useful to trace these books imported from Amsterdam to Paris, or from Paris to Amsterdam. How much did they sell them? I got a problem here. As you can see, the imported music books are not priced, neither in Paris nor in Amsterdam. The transfer price from the printer to the bookseller and the list prices from the bookseller to the customer will remain unknown, I'm afraid. We know that Ballard and Roger received the catalogues from each other, and obviously they did not want their competitor to know the list price of what they had bought from him. Secret of trade. The only list price for imported music books are found in the 1744 catalogue of Michel Charles Le Seine, who took the Roger business over. These prices are too late to make a significant comparison, and the music was totally old-fashioned anyway. In Amsterdam, Estienne Roger was a rough competitor. He reprinted many books taken from the Ballard catalogue. How much did he sell them? I made another sample of music books first printed in Paris by Ballard and then printed in Amsterdam by Roger, using the currency rate between the Livre Tournois and the Dutch Guilder. We can say that the Roger reprints were about 10 to 15% more expensive in Amsterdam than in Paris, due to currency rates only. I did not compare them to the cost of life and so on. This is another story. But for dramatic music, Roger had no privilege to pay to the composer, so he was saving thousands of guilders in pirating editions printed in Paris. So his business must have been quite profitable. The last kind of sources I wanted to look at are the book sales catalogues. For music collections, these catalogues are more and more used from 1710 on in France. Here is one. You can see one of them here, where the hammer price, or what we think could be the hammer price, is written on the right of the page. I have analyzed such prices between 1711 and 1738. I am studying these music catalogues for now on a much larger basis, but I took a few examples only. We can see that for the same edition, the prices vary very widely, depending, of course, of binding, preservation, age, rarity, and so on. For the same print, they can vary from 1 to 3. The sales price can be much higher than the list price. An opera by Lully can be sold up to £24 when the list price was from £11 to £14 only. The highest prices are seen on dramatic music, and especially the Lully operas and his first successors. Because these music books were thick and expensive scores, but also because they have been collected by many amateurs. In Paris, the dramatic repertory of the Académie Royale de Musique has been greedily collected by amateur nobles and bourgeois from the time of Lully to the middle of the 18th century. These scores have formed the base of all the great music collections. So when a music print became rare, it was sought after, and sometimes the reprints were made only 20 or 30 years after the original edition. So the original edition was really difficult to find. In conclusion, as you could notice, the information we can retrieve from different kinds of sources, contracts, catalogues, and so on, draw a figure which is changing from a time to another and from a place to another, but I feel it is overall consistent. Thank you.